Okay. My name's Talia Wheatley. I was a graduate student with Dan Wegner many years ago. My graduate students are here, so it's a real treat for me to have Dan's academic grandchildren. They're sitting, do you guys raise your hand? I'll give you a picture of them. There they are. So it's sort of this intergenerational celebration of Dan's career and our careers and how he put us on these paths. And I should also thank Dan Gilbert, actually, because Dan was a professor of mine when I was an undergraduate. I was a political science major. I took Intro to Social Psychology because it sounded easy as an elective. Dan Gilbert was my professor. That was it, right? I decided this was going to be my major. I became an undergraduate RA for Dan. And Dan said, I think I know someone who you would fit well with for graduate school. So I have a lot to thank for these Dans. When I was a graduate student, this guy spent a lot of time in the lab. This is Little Op, the puppet, named, as you might think, because he looks a lot like Op Dijksterhaus. Little Op's been around the lab a long time. He was born at UVA, and then he moved with Dan to Harvard. And everybody loved this puppet, with a couple of exceptions. But I've heard Little Op's side of the story, and I believe him. I'm starting off with a puppet, which is slightly weird, because this puppet represents something that goes far deeper than his little felted skin. This puppet, to me, represents all the strange and wonderful places you will go if you ask really interesting questions. Questions like, what's happening in people's dreams? This is Meg Kozak, a graduate student. Ouija boards. You'll go to hypnosis, places like White Bears, ridiculously heavy coffee cups that Dan did. Hidden brain damage scales, zombies, party tricks, and even making people tap out secrets with their toes. All of these places Dan Wegner has been, and weirder places still. And when he goes to these places, he makes the most of it. He asks people the very deep, probing questions that get at the core of the matter. Questions like, is the puppet really telling the truth? And how much mind would a dead person have if a dead person could have a mind? Whoops, there. So these questions may seem a little strange and absurd, but the beauty of it is that they're not silly. They're deep and profound. What I'd learned from Dan is that if you ask a really interesting question, you just have to follow that question wherever it leads, even if it leads to unconventional places. In fact, some of the deepest questions require unconventional approaches. You just have to follow where the question will take you down the rabbit hole. Of course, that means you must have an interesting question, right? It's only as good as your question is. So, whoops, sorry. My question comes from, I hope that isn't, okay. My question comes from my childhood in many ways. I spent my childhood in the UK in the 1970s looking at really drug trippy, quirky, stop motion animations. And this is just what was on television, and I was just entranced by it. I thought it was wonderful, magical, it was an escape for me. And yet, at the same time, I think that it seems, these things seem trippy and unreal, but they're capturing something that is very real, and that sort of intrigued me. And so my research question is, how is it that things with no life of their own can still capture the essence of humanity that can evoke deep emotions within us? Of course, I wasn't the first to have this question. Lots of people before me have had it, including something Fritz Heider and Marianne Simmel 70-odd years ago. They showed people these little animations like this. And, yeah. And they're sort of taking the approach there of how low can you go? How sort of stripped down can you make this so that people will attribute all these rich emotions and personalities and animacy to something as simple as a couple of shapes? And Sarah Jane Blakemore and Jean Dassetti figured out that it's in the interactivity, it's in the contingency of the motion. But I think that they actually could have gone lower. And if there's anything I'm comfortable with, it's a low bar and sneaking underneath it. So I thought, well, let's go lower than that. Let's take interactivity out of the question. Let's just reduce it to a single shape. Can we do that? Is it possible to get the dynamics of emotion out of a single shape? And so to answer this question, this is really tricky, okay. I started playing with a lot of balls. And my graduate students started playing with a lot of balls. And I just love the term balls. It's a funny word, let's just get over it, right? My graduate students were like, can we just say ovoid shapes or spheres or eggs? No, it's balls. So I played with a lot of balls. I played with balls that, I don't know where, there go, that drop down and get sucked up and twirl, and what balls where you're coming in and balls that are coming at you, and balls that spin, and all sorts of balls. And I thought, okay, so we've played around with all these balls. Now we're ready to try to make balls feel. Can we make balls feel? So, yes, we can. Here's a proud ball. I've got to figure out where to stand here. Here's a happy ball. Here's an angry ball, right? Faceless, limbless, eyeless blobs can evoke social concepts. They can even evoke empathy. Whoops. Maybe. Jeez. Okay.
You need some help?
Hank, is Hank here? Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Okay. Come on. There you go. Yes. Thank you all. Okay. It's simply just change over time. It's all the dynamics. There's no faces. There are no eyes. There's nothing else we could possibly get these attributions from. It's just the dynamics. But that isn't very satisfying scientifically to just say, well, it's in the dynamics. What dynamics are giving us these attributions? Why sadness, not happiness? Why anger, not fear? And to find this, we had to create a program, or Bo Sievers, a graduate student of mine, did, in which we gave people 5 slider bars. So you imagine you're a subject coming in to the laboratory, and you're sat down in front of 5 slider bars. One slider bar governs the animation of the ball and makes it go faster. So you're told, you're going to create this animation. Here's the ball, and we start it bouncing. Now you can make it go faster or slower. The next bar makes it bounce regularly or irregularly. The other one, whether it tilts up or down, how big the jumps are, and whether the texture of the ball gets smooth or spiky over time. Right? 5 different dynamic features. You get to play with it. It's a big possibility space, and you're told, and now we want you to create something that looks angry. Okay, so they move it around, they find something that looks angry, they save it, say, okay, now make Mr. Ball look happy. Okay, and so forth, for all different emotions. And what we can do with this is that we can quantify them by where they put the slider bars. So here's what people do for angry and peaceful. And the important point is that people put these slider bars in very consistent places. They have a big space to play with, but they put angry in always the same configuration, peaceful in a distinct place, sad, etc. But dynamics are not only visual. As you know, if you've ever listened to someone speak or listened to a song, you know that emotion can be conveyed in tone of voice. You can get swept up in the emotionality of a piece of music. And so we also wanted to study music. Here's a song by The Cure, because Dan loves The Cure. These lyrics say, I waited hours for this. I've made myself so sick. I wish I'd stayed asleep today, right? Sort of maudlin dreck that you expect from The Cure. and if you went with the lyrics, you'd think, oh, this is going to put me in a somber mood. I've got to get ready for this. But then if you actually listen to it, right, and you've probably heard this before.
I'm
Right, that's not sad, okay? Right? That's happy. In fact, I'm gonna say that's happy ball music. Okay, so you can put this music that behind all these different animations, and you can get this sort of compound additive effect, right? You can do it with angry. Pride. Even sad. It even, I think, is super additive. It's no longer the sad ball, right? It's the orb of gloom or the sphere of despair or something. It's more than sad now. They seem to kind of couple with each other, these dynamics, which made us think that maybe they're the same thing. Do emotions have the same dynamics in music and movement that allows them to lay down these deep emotional grooves? And so we actually showed this by going back to the program. What I didn't tell you about the program is that it not only allows people to make animations, but it allows people to make music. So you can have people come down to the lab and sit them in front of the 5 slider bars, and they make the animations of the ball as I described. Or you can have them come in and sit down in front of the 5 slider bars and have them create music. You don't even tell them it's an animation program. They're listening to music, they're creating the music themselves in exactly the same way. So instead of rate governing the speed of the bouncing ball, now rate just governs the speed, the tempo of the notes that they're hearing. And you can do this for all the slider bars isomorphically. You just change, it's not operating on the ball anymore, it's operating on notes. So instead of the head tilting up or down, it's pitch going up and down. Size of jump is size pitch jump. Smooth spiky is mapped to consonants and dissonance by way of David Huron. And these isomorphic mappings allow us to ask whether or not people make angry music the same way they make angry motion in a very quantifiable, systematic way. So this is just to show you what they kind of make with something like angry. This happy. So you can see that it's not beautiful music, right? You're not going to want to listen to that for a long time. But people can actually do the task. They can move the slider bars around and go, okay, yes, that's happy, that's angry. So what this allowed us to ask then is, okay, so you've got the same 5 slider bars, the same 5 dynamic features, you've got them visualized into animations or sonified into music. Are they essentially the same? And what we found is that emotion explains almost all of the variants of where people put the slider bars. That is, if you ask people to make something happy, they'll put the slider bars in a very specific configuration that's consistent across subjects, but it's the same configuration regardless of whether they're working with music or movement. Modality doesn't matter at all. So angry sounds is angry moves, happy sounds is happy moves. Okay. And you can actually plot this slightly differently. You can just say, okay, these are 5 dimensions in space. I'm only going to plot 3, obviously, because it would be difficult to plot 5. But you can plot them and get, like, this is where sad is in the space, and this is where happy is. And then if you lay them down onto a dendrogram, these are actually the data. These are the sort of coordinates in the space. And you can see that, happy has its own coordinate in space, but it's the same for happy music and happy movement. Same is true across the board. It's emotion that matters, not whether it's coming in through your eyes or your ears. And this shouldn't surprise any cognitive neuroscientists in the audience, because cognitive neuroscientists who study music and those who study biological motion, they're separate groups right now, they're all converging on the same area, and that is on the side of the head, superior temporal sulcus. And in fact, we did a study, a multivoxel pattern analysis study, to show that emotion conveyed in movement and emotion conveyed in music are being represented in the same area. So the question, though, that's always thorny, especially when you're dealing with music, is are you dealing with some weird Western sample, some weird Western philosophy about music, or is some quirk of the English language that people are using the terms the same way? So we took it out of Hanover and traveled halfway around the world to a hill tribe in Cambodia, where it was pretty remote. This is us macheting through the jungle to get to the tribe. Jason Mitchell saw this recently and asked me if this was us leaving Hanover. It was good. We got to this tribe. We set up in a hut. This is Bo Seaver's graduate student. They're explaining the task with the slider bars to the tribe's people. Okay, right. These people have never seen computers before, let alone animations. They don't even actually create music. They have tribal music that's been handed down for generations, and that's it. So this is quite a novel task for them, right? We did manage to make the slider bars actual knobs, so we didn't have to teach them how to use a computer mouse. But other than that, it's the same. And we wanted to know, okay, the results that we get in the US, do we get them all the way over in the remotest place we could get to? And the answer is yes. Not only do they represent their emotions the same way in music and movement, they represent each emotion the same way that we do here. So sad has its own dynamic signature that's different from angry, different from happy, and each of those are cross-modal. So dynamic signatures of emotion are cross-modal and cross-cultural. This is why we can understand people from all over the world in terms of what emotion they're conveying, even if we don't understand their language. So we knew what we were doing when we went and why we were there. They were pretty confused by the whole thing. They helped us out. It was a great relationship. We were there for a month. But it was a pretty weird thing to be asking them to do. This one tribes person actually said to me through translators, I understand what I do. I get up. I go out to the field. I harvest grain so that we can eat. I do not understand what it is that you do. Fair enough, right? Even the one Western white face we saw while we were there for a month, this guy, Western, science-minded, mid-30s, he came through, and he's surprised to see us there, right, said, what are you guys doing? And so we told him what we were doing, showed him our stimuli, and then we said, well, what are you here for? And he said, I'm here to teach them sustainable agriculture. But I'm sure this, whatever you're doing, is important too. Thank you. And we sort of replied, we like to think so. Not sure what to say to that, sustainable agriculture. What we should have said is, yes, we're discovering a universal human language, right? A language so deep it resides in our bodies and in our tongues. But like a witty retort, you think of 20 seconds too late to be useful. That was thought of 20 seconds too late to be useful. True to my training in the Wegener Lab, I've gone down the rabbit hole in all sorts of ways to study interesting questions. And it's taken me on a strange but wonderful and unconventional journey from little red balls to the inner workings of the human mind to halfway around the world, all to answer one question that just kind of interested me, which was, why do these things captivate us? Why do music and animation delight us? And I think the answer is that these things distill the very essence of emotion, right? They capture the key dynamics without all the clutter. That's why we respond to them so well. They may be physically unreal, but they're psychologically real. This isn't the end of the bottom of this rabbit hole, and there are many others that we're chasing. I just want to take a second to thank Dan for instilling in me this sort of Wegnerian wanderlust to just ask deep questions and go wherever they take me. I think it makes science incredibly fun. Thank you, Dan.